Skyboat Media presents Strange Attractors, Book 2 of the Chaos Chronicles by Jeffrey A. Carver. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki. For Nancy, in loving memory, and for those Palmers, Phil in memory, and Faye, and Andrew, and Suzanne. Strange Attractors. Noun 1. Chaos theory. Patterns of turbulence. Harmonies underlying disorder. 2. In phase space, channels of order emerging from uncertainty. Paths of transformation. 3. Shipworld sociology. Unseen forces tending to bring disparate energies and intelligences into convergence. Purposefulness of intent remains conjectural. I have not yet spoken of the aesthetic appeal of Strange Attractors. These systems of curves, these clouds of points, suggest sometimes fireworks or galaxies. A realm lies here to be explored and harmonies to be discovered. David Rule, Strange Attractors. Prelude. Journal entry by John Bandicut. Earth date unknown. As I record this, I find myself wondering just who am I addressing? Julie, Cracky, Dakota? I feel as if I want to write a letter, but I am thousands of light years from you now. I can only imagine all of you as you were before I left. You've probably all been dead for centuries, but really I have no way of knowing. How much time has passed? I can only guess. All I can do, then, is speak my thoughts into these stones and pray that they will one day be heard by someone who cares, though I have little hope that it will be anyone human. Still, I must not abandon whatever hope I have. There is so much I don't know. So very much. Have you ever heard voices in your head, voices that could lead you to do stranger things than you could imagine? It's a trick question, really. If the answer is yes, you're either a neurolinker or crazy. If you neurolink, you just go to the nearest data jack to hear voices. I had to go to Neptune and Triton to find the voice that changed my life. But then, that trip turned out to be the shortest leg of the journey. If you're a neurolinker, the data net practically defines your existence. I know that even without knowing who you are. I was one of you once. But if you've ever lost your neuro, then you know the emptiness of never again having that sea of awareness lapping at your mind, offering you every sort of connection imaginable. It is almost the most terrifying loss I can think of. Almost. I faced that loss, and it scared me as much as deafness and blindness rolled into one, but even that wasn't half as frightening as what came later. When the inner silence broke, and a voice told me to sacrifice everything I had to save a world I barely knew anymore. And that, of course, is what got me where I am now. Somewhere out here on the edge of eternity, friendless, at least in the beginning. Fine friendships have come to me since, of course, but nothing can erase the terror, the stark loneliness of what I faced in that first view of the galaxy. Am I being melodramatic? Probably. If Charlie were in my head now, I am sure he would chide me for it. But Charlie's not here. He's dead right now. I'm sure he'll speak his piece later, when he rejoins me. Chapter 1. At Eternity's Edge. He had survived. John Bandicut knew that, and little more. What he did know didn't reassure him. He was trapped inside a structure of immense proportion and unknown nature, somewhere outside the galaxy of his birth. The image still blazed in his mind long after it was blocked from his view. The vast spiral ocean of the Milky Way splayed across the sky before him, with its glittering stars and its dust lanes and its luminous core. Not around him, or overhead in the sky, but before him. Spread out, in all of its awesome glory. He was marooned half a universe from home in a survey craft built for leisurely orbits around the planet Neptune. Neptune, solar system, Earth. For all practical purposes, they were gone now, along with everyone he had ever known or cared for. Charlie, Julie, Cracky, Lakota, all gone. He had saved Earth from destruction, but he hadn't saved himself, not in any way that gave him comfort. He was alone now, except for a pair of simple robots, and left with the haunting question, who has done this to me, and why? No one had come knocking since his ship had docked, so it seemed if he wanted to learn what sort of place he had been taken aboard, he would have to go out and see for himself. He zipped up the utility backpack and dropped it on the deck. It was stuffed full of rations, a recorder, some spare clothes, and a few simple tools. After a last check of the ship's bridge, he called the robots to the airlock. He reached for his spacesuit, or rather, the spacesuit he had stolen from Triton Station just before he had stolen the spaceship. You didn't steal it, he reminded himself. You borrowed it to save the Earth. He sighed, weary of the memory, and began to unfasten the front seam.
You will not need a spacesuit.
He started at the voice in his head. The translator stone in his right wrist flickered diamond white as it spoke for the first time in several hours. It was a daughter stone of the alien translator that he had found in a cavern on Triton, and a component of the incomprehensible mechanism that had brought him to this place. It was also the closest thing he had to a guide since Charlie the Quarks had died just before impact with the comet. The translator stone seemed to have some knowledge of this place, but it parceled that knowledge out in exceedingly small doses. When it spoke at all, it displayed little interest in answering Bandicut's questions. Bandicut frowned. How sure are you about that? He asked silently, reluctant to hang the spacesuit back up.
You will not need a spacesuit.
Bandicut grunted and left the spacesuit hanging. Beside him, the two mining robots that had accompanied him from Triton whirred and clicked quietly. Ready, boys? He asked. Fully charged? Copernicus, a low-slung tunnel surveyor on wheels shaped like fat horizontal ice cream cones, replied with a light drum tap.
Aye, Cap'n.
Napoleon, shaped like a cross between a monkey and a chest-high grasshopper, and built for walking rather than rolling, flexed its knees in a quick plié and said,
Ready, John Bandicut.
Bandicut hefted one strap of the bag over his shoulder, took a deep breath, and hit the airlock button. The outer door thunked open. He blinked, facing a featureless, meter-deep boarding passageway ending in a purplish bulkhead. So, he frowned. An instant later, the bulkhead dissolved, revealing a long, smooth-walled corridor, gloomily lit. At its far end, the corridor bent to the right. Bandicut swallowed. Twice. Then he took his first step onto an alien world. It didn't feel like much as his foot touched the floor. The gravity felt the same, a little heavy for one recently accustomed to the 1/13th G of Triton, but that change had occurred earlier at the moment of docking. He stepped into the corridor and paused to see if his hosts would appear or maybe just strike him dead.
Proceed.
He blinked. Was the translator stone receiving messages, or did it already know what Bandicut was about to encounter? He had no idea what world the translator was from. Could this place be its home? He didn't bother asking. Okay, he said, and glanced back at the robots. Let's go, boys. He started down the passageway. The robots clicked and thrummed behind him. The walls of the corridor gave off a satiny sheen. The violet light seemed stronger ahead. It flickered with an erratic, strobe-like intensity that soon made him feel a little dizzy. He put out a steadying hand. The wall was cool to the touch and finely textured. There was something more to the touch, though. He felt a momentary mental dizziness and a sudden urgency to keep moving. Not quite an encouragement and not quite a threat. It was more like a sense of need. Like the urgency that might have been conveyed by an approaching siren. Do you know what that is? He asked nervously. The stones did not answer. He rounded the bend, and the passageway widened. On the left wall were a number of indecipherable panels, with strangely fuzzy, flickering lights that didn't seem to illuminate anything. Bandicut clicked on a handheld lantern and flashed it around briefly before continuing onward. The passage narrowed again, but the violet strobe was growing brighter. Followed by the whirring robots, Bandicut rounded a second bend to the left and entered a large, oval chamber. It looked a little like the lobby of a theater, darkened, but with pools and flashes of light radiating into the darkness. It was roughly circular, with dark panels lining most of the outer wall. To his right, a pool of violet light flickered, apparently created by shifting, sparkling patterns in the adjacent walls and ceiling. This was the source of the strobe. It looked almost as if it were intended to spotlight some object, a sculpture perhaps, some absent work of art. Dropping his backpack, Bandicut squinted at a broad glass partition that appeared to bisect the chamber. On the far side of the glass was what looked like a control room, though he quickly saw that it was in fact a wide hallway that swept out of view in both directions. Directly opposite, on the far wall of the control room, were four panels with screens and controls, shaped and indented in ways that clearly suggested non-human users. "Anyone there?" he murmured, rapping softly on the partition with his knuckles. His rapping was silent, at least to his ears. There was no one visible. On his side of the room, a series of lights came on. He turned. The wall panels were glowing now, perhaps in response to his voice. They looked like video or holo screens. Images came into focus, different images in each one. They were all landscapes. Desert, forest, lake, shattered moonscape. And they were changing. Blink, every second or so. He scanned the panels in bewilderment. Marsh, blink. Glacier, blink. Red sun. City structures, vast rooms, blink, blink, incomprehensible mechanical structures, blink, 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 at an accelerating rate. "What is this?" he whispered. The robots clicked and whirred, and Napoleon strode toward him.
"We are in a flattened oval chamber, approximately 12 meters in diameter, 3 meters in height."
"Yes, Nappy, I can see that. I was hoping for more useful insight." Napoleon fell silent. But Copernicus rolled toward the glass partition.
"Captain, movement beyond the pane."
Bandicut whirled.
"You're 10 o'clock, Captain."
Bandicut peered through the glass and finally saw a small machine gliding along the base of the far wall, just coming into the control room area. It looked like a tiny robot, casting a faint sideways swath of light across the floor. Something looked odd about that light. It was dim but sparkling. As the little machine passed in front of him, Bandicut realized that within the fan of light, myriad particles were gleaming, rising into the robot. "It's vacuuming. The damn thing is vacuuming." He glanced at Copernicus.
"Isn't that what it looks like to you?"
Copernicus whirred.
"Uncertain of the reference, Captain."
Bandicut knocked on the partition again, but the little robot ignored him, passed the length of the control area, and disappeared down the hallway to the right. Bandicut pressed his fingers in frustration against the glass and was startled to realize that it was perfectly smooth. No dirt, no grit, no sensation of it being a material surface. He remembered an impassable barrier that he had encountered once on Triton, surrounding the alien translator. He sighed and spoke silently to the translator stones in his wrists. "What is this place? Does anyone live here? What am I supposed to be doing?
Damn it, step under the lights."
He blinked. "Lights?"
"Behind you."
He turned, frowning, toward the pool of light in the corner. "And do what?"
"Communicate. We will translate."
Bandicut stared at the strobing light. Communicate with whom, he wondered. And if someone wanted to communicate with him, why didn't they come out in person? Copernicus rolled toward the lights, as if it had heard Bandicut's inner dialogue. It paused at the edge of the light, rotating its sensor array.
Electromagnetic fields, Captain. Shall I attempt measurements?
Bandicut was about to reply in the affirmative when the translator stones urged him forward with a sharp tingle in both wrists.
Step under the lights. Without delay, please. Bring your possessions.
He blinked in confusion, but felt a faint tingle of confirmation as he picked up his bag and stepped forward. Copy. Would you mind carrying this? He set the bag on the robot's back, and Copernicus closed the manipulator arm to secure it. Thanks. You two keep a sharp eye out, and stay close to me. He felt another tingle of confirmation. But he also recalled his very first encounter with the alien translator, years ago it seemed, in the cavern on Triton, and how useless his suit scanners had been in gathering any real information. Stay real close, he murmured. Napoleon stepped beside him with the delicacy of an oversized granddaddy longlegs. Bandicut took a deep breath, comforted by the presence of the robots. As he stepped into the violet pool, a ray of light strobed in his eyes. He flinched. Hello? Anyone here? For an instant, nothing. Then the strobes splintered, and shards of light flashed around him like rain. In an instant, he was enveloped in a coruscating cocoon of light, colors changing at a dizzying speed. He wanted to flee, but the floor had turned to fire beneath him. He could not move. The light brightened, until it seemed not so much like dazzling rays in his eyes as an inner light, and something else, a presence of something vaster and more powerful, something aware, something intelligent. It stirred in his mind just beyond the limits of his own consciousness. It knew he was here. It was interested in him. And then it blossomed, transforming itself into something that was color and sound and smell and none of those things. And then the bottom fell out of it all, and he felt his consciousness slipping away. To his surprise, he did not actually lose consciousness. With a heart-stopping shift, he felt his consciousness expanding, not in size or space, but in dimension. He felt his mind unfolding like a vast convoluted paper fan, his memories separating and opening. The presence moved in silence through his thoughts, exploring memories that were sorting themselves out into the open. It was an oddly familiar sensation. It reminded him of the probing that he had once endured from the translator, but this felt more methodical, in a certain way gentler, yet if anything, more powerful than the translator's probe. He felt a useless impulse to guard his memories. He no longer had Charlie here protecting him, or trying to justify what was happening.
Charlie,
sighed a faint voice. And then something folded again, and the memory shifted away. How he wished that voice were more than a memory. If only Charlie hadn't died. The first time it had happened, the quarks had come back to life within hours. But now, all Bandicut seemed to have were the memories. This thing felt quite different from the quarks. Stranger. Potentially more threatening.
Who are you?
His whisper of thought emerged in slow motion. He sensed a glimmer of awareness in reply.
Wish to perceive and understand.
He blinked inwardly. Then he heard another whisper, in a voice like Charlie's.
You must listen.
He drew a sharp breath. Had he imagined those words? Charlie! He called out. Instead of Charlie, though, he felt that other presence deepen its touch, scalpel sharp. This time it didn't stop at brushing open the folds of his memories. It began taking them apart, illuminating them with its own darkly flickering inner light, as he remembered. Silence fugue, as if it had happened just moments ago. The madness that had driven him across the silent emptiness of the Triton landscape under Neptune's frown, veering his survey rover off the assigned course, the madness that was soon to take him into the presence of the mysterious translator. The shocking appearance of the quarks in his mind, placed there by the translator, and the revelation that he had been chosen to sacrifice everything to save the Earth from an invisible danger. Which was harder to accept, the uninvited presence of the alien, or the mission being thrust upon him? Or the quarks' own uncertainty about what exactly the mission was? The absurd figure of a talking holographic dinosaur, explaining why they were to steal a spaceship and then cross the solar system in an impossible race to collide headlong with a comet. The quick, attractive movements of Julie Stone as she played Einy Steiny, knocking planets into the gravity wells of the 3D pool table. The warm, whispering movements of Julie as she made love to him. The shudders of pleasure that he would never know again because he was going to steal a spaceship and fly to his certain death. Or almost certain death, because when he actually careened into the comet, releasing more energy than a million hydrogen bombs, he was somehow translated across space and perhaps time as well to a place thousands of light years from home, on the outside of his own galaxy, and not just marooned, but alone, because the quarks had died instead of him. And only a little later, approaching a vast structure floating somewhere above the disk of the Milky Way, until the structure silently drew him and his ship into itself. Why? Why? And a whispering voice answered, "Because you are needed." And before he could assimilate that, the memories abruptly shifted and whirled to earlier times, and in a dizzying rush, he saw his childhood replayed in glimpses too fast to focus upon. The loneliness and struggle, the family he loved, but always at a strained distance. His discovery that his family had been taken from him in a terrible accident. His niece, Dakota, the only remaining relative he cared for. "Why?" he murmured, struggling to put meaning to all this. And he thought he heard two voices trying to be heard. And then one whispered,
"Because you are needed, that is all."
And he wasn't a bit sure that it had answered the same question he had meant to ask. The images changed abruptly, and it was no longer anything familiar, but memories of places he had never seen. Alien landscapes, alien suns, alien creatures, tall, stooping, billowing. Floating in gaseous seas, creeping in frozen wastes, floating in the dark of space, faster, flickering, the visions came too fast to comprehend. And then everything changed. And he began spinning, twisting in space and time, turning inside out. And not just twisting, but changing. Not his soul or his being, but something in his body being altered profoundly. Then light and dark collided, and splinters of light shot through darkness, and he was aware of a dazzlingly bright fire in the middle of it all, and he sensed without understanding that he could not possibly approach that fire without dying. But then he tumbled, not just toward it, but through it. Chapter 2, Snow and Ice. He flailed, trying to gain control. He staggered and realized that he was neither floating nor falling, but standing on a hillside. It was cold, and a bright sun blazed in his eyes. The room and the pool of light were gone, and his ears were ringing with the sound of fading voices. In their place, he heard a whistling wind and a low, continuous thunder. He gasped, trying to focus. Through a blur, he thought he saw a landscape covered with snow and ice. Snow and ice? That explained why he felt a brisk chill through his thin jumpsuit. His thoughts were interrupted by an urgent tapping, metallic. He looked down. He was on some sort of path, with Copernicus parked beside him. At his glance, Copernicus stopped tapping. Napoleon was on his other flank. He felt an abrupt sense of relief. "Record everything," he whispered.
Everything.
He raised his eyes, shading them against the glare.
Where the mokin' folk are we?
They were on the side of an icy hill under what appeared to be a bright sun, peering out over a slope covered with snow-capped trees. Forest stretched as far as he could see.
Mokin folk?
His head was still ringing, and for an instant he thought he heard that voice again, like a haunting echo.
Charlie, is that you?
He heard nothing except the wind and the low thunder. What was this? A bizarre hallucination? He had passed through some sort of transformational process, and it was possible that all of this had been implanted in his mind. But he didn't think so. He felt the weight of gravity under him. He was definitely cold, and his head was starting to clear. He rubbed his arms and hugged himself. No, he was pretty sure that he was really standing on a snow and ice-covered hillside. He squinted, but couldn't see the sun too clearly. The sky was a pale, featureless blue-gray. Every sense told him that he was standing on the surface of a planet. But that, he murmured, is ridiculous. He was answered by Copernicus's metallic tapping. The two robots looked like a pair of metal dogs at his side. Copernicus's sensor array was rotating. Napoleon was beeping softly to itself, shifting its head, as though to gain understanding. What are you two seeing?
The robots spoke at once. Ranging exceeds design parameters. Loss of continuity.
Cannot reconcile conflicting input.
One at a time. Nappy? Copernicus clicked and became still. Napoleon bobbed.
John Bandicut, I experience a loss of continuity with conflicting data. I observed a bright influx of visible light, then a period of numerous error interrupts, lasting approximately 9 minutes. The time measurement is uncertain.
Bandicut rubbed his arms again, rapidly.
Do you have any idea what happened?
He could see his breath against the wintry landscape. He opened his bag on Copernicus's back and rummaged for a lightweight jacket, the closest thing he had to exposure garb.
Uncertain, said Napoleon. I also noted a fluctuation in gravitational readings. Those data may be corrupted. Negative correlation with norms in the Triton database.
Bandicut shrugged into his jacket. Nappy, we're not on Triton anymore.
Acknowledge, John Bandicut.
The robot's sensor eyes looked almost thoughtful for a moment.
But that is the only database at my disposal.
You might want to start compiling a new one. Bandicut gazed upslope. Not far above them, overlooking the path, was a smooth stone wall, slick with ice.
I also detected certain changes in my internal systems, Napoleon continued. However, I am unable to characterize those changes. My internal perceptions were themselves undergoing alteration.
Bandicut glanced back. You too, copy? Copernicus drum-tapped acknowledgement.
Yes, Cabin. Cannot elaborate. However, I am now registering a significantly altered environment. I cannot account for its appearance.
That much we can agree upon. What else about the transition? Copernicus ticked softly.
I show a chronology lapse and damaged analysis. Was there a change in programming?
Bandicut blinked out over the snow-covered trees. Yeah, I guess you could say that. I wonder how the hell far we were transported from. His voice caught suddenly. Our ship. Their last piece of Earth. The closest thing they had to a home.
Napoleon stretched to its full height of about a meter. I can provide no information. Inertial alignment was lost during the transition.
Bandicut nodded and squinted at the sky. It looked odd to him, in a way he couldn't put his finger on. Well, whatever the hell happened, I have a feeling we're still not on a planet. He wondered if he had been transported into something like the Earth-orbiting L5 city, a habitat complete with inner landscaping and active ecologies. But if that were so, this bit of wilderness made L5 look like a backyard garden. He hoisted his backpack over his shoulders. Let's see what's along this path. Maybe we can get a better view from up here. He trudged up the path, stepping carefully with his sneakers on the crusted snow. There were no tracks visible, Nonetheless, it did look like a path. The view above the ice-glazed wall was blocked by trees. However, just below the wall, the path appeared to level off on an open ledge. He glanced back. Napoleon was following, but Copernicus's wheelbase was a little large for the path, and it was still trying to get itself turned around, with short back-and-forth movements.
"Copy," he shouted. "Why don't you just stay there a minute? We'll be right back."
He resumed hiking, with Napoleon close behind. "Can you make anything out up there?" he asked, indicating the wall.
"Rock and ice with uncertain spectrographic signatures,"
Napoleon rasped. No reason to be surprised by that. The path petered out, but the ledge afforded a clearer view below. "Take a look here, Nappy." There seemed to be a river. He couldn't see much of it, but here and there through the forest cover he glimpsed water. Maybe that was what the thundering noise was, rapids in the river. He felt better having even that bit of knowledge about his surroundings. "What do you make of these plants?" he puffed through his hands as he bent to examine the underbrush and trees. He resisted an impulse to touch the dark, shiny green leaves of the underbrush. Thoughts of poison ivy and worse went through his mind. The plants were totally unfamiliar, which helped dispel any notion that this whole scene had somehow been created out of his own memories and imagination.
"The location is real,"
he started. "You still here? Can you give me some useful information?" The thought came out with an edge of annoyance. He'd gotten pretty tired of the stone's terse manner.
"We can only provide such information as we have,"
Bandicut grunted. He continued his inspection of the nearby trees. The branch structure was similar to earth trees, except that the branches stuck out horizontally, then curved upward like scimitars. The leaves were pointy clawed, like the outstretched hands of an old crone, purplish on top, and on the underside like coarse black cloth. "Nappy, what do you get on these leaves?" The robot waved flickering sensors.
"These objects, I detect metallic traces, but less than required to meet current mining criteria. What else?"
"Copy. What are you doing here? I thought I told you to wait." The wheeled robot ground to a stop on the ice.
"I thought you might need me, Captain."
Bandicut squinted at Copernicus. Since when had this machine become such an independent thinker? Between Charlie's reprogramming efforts and whatever they'd just been through, he wondered how much these robots of his had changed.
"I see.
Well, do you have any data on plant life?" Copernicus made a buzzing sound like a stalled motor.
"Don't think so, Captain."
"Nappy?"
"Negative, John Bandicut. Please define plant life."
"You're looking at it. That's a tree. It's a form of plant life. So is this underbrush, and," he pointed, "the foliage growing on this wall."
"Unfamiliar with those forms, Captain," said Copernicus.
Nappy turned its head one way, then another, like a large bird taking in its surroundings. Bandicut frowned, wondering whether his robots were going to be any help at all here. Or were they too far out of their league? He shook his head, shivering at the thought of having only himself to depend on. "Well, never mind. Let's head down toward that river. If nothing else, we might be able to find drinkable water. And maybe then..." His voice trailed off. He had no idea where he wanted to go from here. The realization had just hit him all over again that he was now stranded in an alien world, separated even from his spacecraft. He had better find food, water, and shelter soon.
"Agreed."
"Thanks," he thought sarcastically. And then maybe he could start worrying about who had brought him here and why. His hands and feet were growing numb as he headed down the slope, but at least by moving around he was generating some heat. The path switched back and forth, giving him the occasional fresh glimpse of the band of water below. Across the river, the land rose again, completing a gentle canyon of rock and forest. Everything seemed capped with snow and ice. Across the river, the slopes were backed up against more hills, and the horizon, as he looked at it now, it seemed more band-like than he had realized before. A wall? He felt more certain than ever that this was an astonishingly sophisticated closed habitat, not a planetary surface.
He could not escape a feeling of awe at the power that had created this place. But how eager was he to meet its creators in person? He peered again at the sun. It was too bright to focus on, but he thought it looked a little small. Was it really a sun, or some other kind of light source? He wasn't sure whether it had moved in the sky or not. Downslope, the path grew uneven, which made it difficult for the robots. They were having trouble with traction on the ice and snow, which was far more slippery than the cryogenic ices they had been built for on Triton. He kept glancing back at them. As a result, he almost didn't see the spot where the path dropped and twisted sharply to the right. He caught himself in mid-stride. For a frightening instant, he felt his body warring between his 1/13th G reflexes from Triton and the 1G that was about to tumble him over. He swayed, arms out, then brought his weight back around onto the path. With a gasp, he looked up at the robots, Copernicus churning up a small cloud of snow particles with his conical wheels, and Napoleon goose-stepping behind. "Slow down, you two! There's a steep drop, right?" Copernicus slewed to a stop, teetering at the edge. How the hell was it going to nose down over that dip and make the right-angle turn?
"Steep drop here, Captain," the robot remarked. "Shall I give it a try?"
"Hold on a sec. Napoleon, can you help copy around that?" Bandicut remembered far too clearly how the robots, because they weren't programmed for higher gravity gradients, had once knocked loose a set of heavy tanks back on the spaceship and nearly killed him. The legged robot edged up beside its partner and peered over. Without speaking, it braced its upper arms on Copernicus and swung its lower legs around to back down the drop-off like a small child negotiating stairs. Backing partway around, it groped for a secure handhold on Copernicus and said, "Proceed slowly. I will apply leverage." Bandicut tugged nervously at his backpack straps, watching. Copernicus inched forward until its front wheels hung out over the drop-off and its belly rasped on the ice. It ground for purchase with its rear wheels, pushing itself out until the front wheels suddenly dropped, whirring for traction. Napoleon strained to lever the wheeled robot around the bend.
"You got him, Nappy?"
"Attempting,"
Napoleon began, just as Copernicus lost traction in its back wheels. All four wheels spun in a cloud of ice particles. It slid sideways. There was no way Napoleon could stop it as it teetered at the corner, then toppled over the edge.
"Stop, Copernicus!" Napoleon rasped.
There was no use. Copernicus was tumbling, and Napoleon went over with it, down the slope.
"Wait!" Bandicut yelled futilely.
He winced as the two machines bounced apart, slamming through snow and foliage, and disappeared through the trees.
"Are you all right?"
he shouted. There was no answer, just the continuous rumble of the river.
Damn.
For an instant, he considered following them down the slope, but that would be dumb. Better to run on ahead and hope the path switched back again. He hurried, slipping a little on the crusty snow. The path wound through a dense thicket of shrubs, all brittle with ice crystals, then cut back left, descending sharply into the stand of trees where the robots had vanished. Ahead, almost at his level now, he glimpsed the silver ribbon of water. But he saw no sign of either robot.
"Napoleon! Copernicus!" he yelled.
Over the thunder of the river, he heard a snap. He squinted, casting his gaze around.
Snap!
He saw nothing moving, but it sounded like branches breaking.
"Nappy? Copy?"
He peered up through the trees, trying to gauge where the two must have fallen. He couldn't be sure. He hurried on. Not much farther ahead, the trees opened up to reveal the riverbank. He must have missed the robots or their trail somehow. Perhaps the smartest thing would be to reconnoiter along the bank, then backtrack if he didn't find them. He continued out of the trees, where the path snaked along a narrow strip beside the water. He paused to catch his breath. It was a stunningly beautiful panorama. The river was about 20 meters wide, shallow, fast-moving, glistening over icy boulders. The water was clear, and he could see numerous large flat rocks both above and below the surface. To his right, the river swept into sight from around a large elbow of land on his side. To his left, the water rushed over the boulder-strewn bed and crooked away around a massive outcropping on the far shore. The thundering was coming from that direction. Bandicut tucked his hands under his armpits, shivering. It was beautiful, yes. But just now he was starting to think more about freezing to death.
We can help.
He blinked. What's that? He felt a sudden twinge of heat in both wrists and a flush of warmth in his torso. Thanks, he thought with a shiver of relief. Why'd you wait so long?
Our reserves are limited.
He grunted, gazing down into the river. He wondered if it would kill him to drink the water. He wondered if there was some way to test it other than the hard way.
Crack!
He turned back towards the woods. That had sounded more like breaking ice than branches.
Hello? He shouted. Copy? Nappy?
A moment later, he heard a crash and a whir of motors. Copernicus tumbled out of the trees, a short distance downriver from where Bandicut stood. It landed on its wheels, then spun for traction as it slid over sloping ice toward the water. Its motors whined, reversing futilely.
Oh, moke, Bandicut breathed.
At that instant, Napoleon crashed out of the trees as well, curled up in a protective ball. It bounced across the ice after Copernicus, kicking up puffs of ice dust. Bandicut watched in horror as the robots careened toward the water.
Whirr!
Copernicus's wheels picked up some traction, but it was moving too fast, and it tumbled over the bank and crashed into the water. Napoleon slammed into the rocky bank, bounced over Copernicus, and hit the water with an even bigger splash. Bandicut cursed and ran to the edge of the bank. He had no idea if the robots were waterproof, and half expected them to short out before his eyes. He dropped his backpack, then hesitated. What the hell did he think he was going to do? He could freeze if he went into that water. And for all he knew, it could be full of poisons or God knew what else. For that matter, he didn't even know for sure that it was water and not some other clear liquid. He blinked, waiting to see if the robots could get out by themselves. Copernicus had landed on its back, half submerged, its wheels spinning just above the surface. Napoleon had uncurled and was struggling futilely to get to its feet. Look at them, he thought. They're dinosaurs in this goddamn place. There's no way to recharge them, and they're going to run down in a couple of days anyway. And that will be that. Don't be an idiot. Leave them. He swallowed. Don't be a jerk, he thought. They're your friends.
Hang on, you two, he yelled.
And he took a deep breath and strode into the swirling icy waters. Chapter 3. Ice Storm. The water hit him with a frigid shock. He gasped, struggling to stay upright on the treacherous bottom. He reached Copernicus first. All four wheels were spinning uselessly, reversing direction at random. Bandicut shuddered and leaned into the freezing water to see if he could turn the robot over, but it was impossible to get a handhold anywhere, except maybe on the wheels.
Copy, stop spinning, he gasped.
There was no way the robot could hear him. He straightened, trembling from the cold, and moved around to see if he could help Napoleon. The other robot had managed to sit up and was trying to stand. Its metal feet found some purchase on a submerged rock, but as it rose, it flailed suddenly, lost its balance, and toppled back into the water.
Napoleon, are you all right?
Its next attempt was more successful. Whirring and splashing, it rose to a crouch and turned toward Bandicut's voice. Its sensor eyes blinked. It seemed to be having some trouble finding him. Its mechanical hands stretched out as though groping blindly. Bandicut shuffled closer. Right here. Napoleon made a sputtering sound, venting water.
Resetting, it croaked. One moment.
Its sensors flickered, then brightened, and seemed to focus on Bandicut.
John Bandicut, we must remove ourselves. Help me with Copernicus, Bandicut shouted.
Napoleon shifted its eyes, as though seeing Copernicus in the water for the first time. It seemed about to say something, then abruptly raised a metal hand and pointed toward the shore.
John Bandicut, hazard alert, objects approaching.
What? Bandicut twisted to look, nearly losing his footing. He blinked in disbelief. The riverbank had come alive. The ice and snow were fragmenting into chunks as if broken by a silent earthquake. The pieces were vibrating and dancing into the air like drops of water on a hot griddle. Above the path, the slope was erupting almost volcanically, with chunks of snow and ice bouncing up and down out of the trees. Some pieces were not just airborne, but buzzing straight toward Bandicut and the robots. Bandicut threw up a protective arm, just as the first pieces of ice hit him. A few fragments glanced off his arm and shoulder, and one off the side of his head. He reeled in pain. "Jeez," he grunted, and crouched in the freezing water, trying to shield himself.
"John Bandicut, you are in danger," cried Napoleon.
A new fusillade of ice hit him. The robot was being pummeled as well. It rocked, ice ringing off its metal skin, and toppled back into the water with a crash. Mokin, eh? What had they done? Triggered an environmental defense mechanism? "Stones," he cried silently. "If you know what's happening, help me." The black stone in his left wrist burned with momentary heat, and he became aware of a shimmer of light around him. The next pieces of ice hit with less energy. It seemed to be a protective field. It didn't stop the chunks, but slowed them. In the air above the shore, more pieces of ice were buzzing like an angry swarm of bees.
"We are limited without more energy."
Bandicut saw Napoleon struggling to get up again. The water around them was erupting with splashes, like old movies of a naval battle.
"Cry!"
Hearing a loud whistle and a strangled-sounding cry, Bandicut looked back toward the shore. A tall, lanky, humanoid creature was striding along the riverbank, shouting indecipherably and whirling some kind of rope through the air. Was Bandicut about to meet an enemy? A ululating groan came from higher on the slope. The ground was beginning to look like a nightmarish strip mine. The snow cover was half gone, revealing wounded, trembling earth.
"Rah!"
cried the humanoid. It appeared to be running toward Bandicut. As it approached, the angry ice swarm actually settled a little. Bandicut stared at the humanoid. It ceased twirling its length of rope and stood on the riverbank, peering out at him. Had it stopped the attack?
"Hello?"
Bandicut called, shivering. The being cocked its head. How could he make himself understood? He had to get out of here before the exposure killed him. The glow around him was slowly fading as the stones conserved energy. His feet were numb. The being swayed from side to side as though trying to determine what Bandicut was doing out there in the river. Bandicut gestured helplessly to his robots, trembling with urgency. He would have to abandon them soon if he couldn't get them out of the water. Napoleon whistled and shrieked and jerked erect, spraying Bandicut with freezing water.
"John Bandicut, John Bandicut, I am still at your side. Why have you sent Copernicus under the water?"
"I didn't. Help me get him upright." Napoleon stumbled toward his fellow robot.
"Lift that end and try to turn him toward shore."
Napoleon obeyed, bending to avoid the slowly spinning wheels, and found a grip on the end of Copernicus's body.
"Now," Bandicut yelled, "to turn him!"
Whirring and grunting, they both strained, and Copernicus slowly rolled. It also began to slide, not toward shore, but toward Bandicut and deeper water.
"Toward you!" Bandicut yelled.
But Napoleon, too, was losing traction, and Bandicut could feel himself slipping under Copernicus now, unable to stop the slide. His foot had somehow gotten caught under the robot, and he couldn't get out of the way even to let go. He was now up to his waist in the frigid water, and going down. And as the water rushed over his chest, he was stunned to realize that he was in real danger of drowning under the robot.
"Nappy," he choked, taking a mouthful of water. "Pull him back."
There was a splash alongside him. Coughing through the spray, Bandicut saw the tall creature from the riverbank at his side. He struggled to say, but then he slipped backwards. Water lapped over his face. He was aware of the alien creature reaching under Copernicus. An instant later, he felt the weight lift from his leg and body and he struggled to scramble out from under the robot. He staggered, choking, to his feet. He shuddered and pushed weakly against Copernicus and realized that the alien was already helping Napoleon to roll Copernicus.
That's it,
he gasped, as Copernicus crashed into the water, right side up, a meter closer to the riverbank. His teeth chattered as he looked up at his rescuer. The tall being peered back at him from a blue-white face, then gestured toward shore.
Thanks,
Bandicut wheezed, and pushed on Copernicus's nose to steer it back toward the bank. It seemed to be having trouble orienting itself.
Get going,
Bandicut yelled, hitting it weakly on the back. Copernicus finally got traction under its wheels and lumbered over the submerged rocks and up over the short incline onto the riverbank. Napoleon and Bandicut staggered alongside, following their alien rescuer out of the water. Bandicut's legs were completely numb, and he was unable to walk in a straight line. He felt a bony hand on his arm and gasped in gratitude as the alien helped him up the last few steps onto the bank. He sank to his knees.
Hurrah! A walk!
Cried the alien, and Bandicut blinked up at him.
A walk!
The voice of the being was rough and strong and unmistakably urgent.
What?
He panted.
A walk!
The being gestured toward the slope where the chunks of ice had risen to assault them. Bandicut squinted and realized that the snow and ice were still vibrating up and down. He looked back at the being. It was gesturing urgently downriver. Bandicut's breath escaped convulsively.
I don't know if I can move.
He shuddered, feeling a new rush of warmth driving back some of the numbing chill. The black stone in his left wrist was glowing a dull red.
Hey, ga!
Bandicut saw the creature staring at his wrist and the glowing stone. He grunted, wondering if the stone looked frightening or maybe desirable. He gazed into his rescuer's sculpted blue face. A glint of light seemed to come from within its smallish, deep-set black eyes. It emitted a low rumble, then pointed with a long, articulated finger to the side of its own head, to a spot roughly equivalent to the human temple. A gem-like stone was embedded in the creature's temple, and it flickered with a diamond sparkle as the being said,
Eka, yar?
You have one? Two? Bandicut gasped.
The being's eyes blazed with an inner light.
Yar, yes,
it grunted. Its voice seemed sharper, clearer than a moment ago. Bandicut stumbled to his feet, his right wrist tingling sharply.
Moken folk, he whispered. What did you just say?
Yes,
said the being again, cocking its head the other way. But before Bandicut could reply, it jerked around and pointed urgently back at the slope where the ice and snow were shaking, rising into the air.
Must run, Aleka,
it pointed downriver.
Must run.
Bandicut coughed at the robots. Can you guys run? Napoleon rose creakily.
I am functional.
Copernicus jerked violently forward and backward as though trying to gauge the traction.
With you, Cap'n.
Aleka.
Bandicut nodded. Let's go. He saw a flicker on the other's temple, and the alien strode off down the riverbank. Bandicut suddenly remembered his backpack. He scrambled back for it, slung it over his shoulder, and hurried after the alien, with the two robots grinding along behind. A moment later, he was pelted from behind with clods of ice and dirt, and he staggered on his stiff legs, trying to move faster.
Come on, you two,
he shouted to the robots. A cloud of snow and ice was rushing toward them.
Hey,
shrieked the alien.
Hurry!
Bandicut ran, throbbing legs or no. The alien was trotting along the riverbank with a sure-footed gait. It probably could easily have outrun them, but it held to a pace that Bandicut could just barely keep up with. The river bent to the right, past a stand of trees. With luck, once they got past the bend, they would be out of danger. But the background thunder was growing louder. The alien yelled,
Don't Stop!
He saw why. The riverbank ahead of them was becoming as riled as the slope behind them. The alien veered into the water with a splash.
Oh, no, wait, he panted.
But the alien appeared to be crossing at a shallow point, trotting through ankle-deep water, with a glance back every few seconds. Bandicut hesitated at the water's edge, but a chunk of ice slammed into his shoulder blades and convinced him to keep moving.
Come on, you two, he yelled. Don't roll over!
The robots trundled after him, and this time kept upright, plowing through the water close behind him. The numbing cold flashed up Bandicut's legs again. It took all of his strength not to collapse back into the water. He staggered, but kept moving. Where was the alien going? The thundering grew louder. He hoped they weren't going to wade downstream through whitewater rapids. The view beyond the bend was blocked by a large outcropping with overhanging trees, but the alien was heading that way, apparently in an effort to stay close to the far bank. The creature waved them on and disappeared around the bend. As Bandicut hurried around the outcropping, he glanced nervously up at the overhanging trees, praying that nothing would fall down on them. Then he rounded the bend and saw the source of the thundering, a waterfall cascading down a cliff face into the river, and the alien was striding directly toward it.
What? He panted. Are you?
It was too far away to hear. Bandicut glanced back at the robots. Oh, Christ. Napoleon had gone down, and Copernicus had paused beside it. Napoleon clambered back to its feet, leaning on its more compact companion.
Can you keep going? Bandicut yelled.
He ducked as a fusillade of ice scattered into the water around him. Napoleon was up, squawking,
Coming, John Bandicut!
Copernicus revved its wheels, shooting back a stream of water as it surged forward. Bandicut turned and kept moving. The alien was standing in the spray at the base of the waterfall.
Hurrah! It cried, waving its arms. Behind!
Bandicut heard a new rumble. He looked over his shoulder and gasped. The riverbed itself was coming alive. The surface of the water was dancing in agitation as if coming to a boil. Several large boulders were shaking, almost lifting out of the water. Bandicut gaped in disbelief. Farther upstream, the river itself was rising in a large wave.
Napoleon! Copernicus! He screamed. Faster!
The robots rushed in an eruption of spray. Bandicut charged toward the falls, then stumbled to a halt. The alien was gone. Bandicut blinked, half-blinded by the spray.
Hello? He shouted in a hoarse voice. Where are you?
He looked around frantically. The boulders were dancing forward, and behind them the wave was engorging itself into a thunderous wall of water. Directly in front of the wave, the barren riverbed was exposed, where the water was being drawn up like an indrawn breath.
Hi-yee!
The alien dashed out of the waterfall, gesturing wildly, then turned and vanished back into it. Bandicut gaped at the falls thundering before him, its spray drenching him.
What are you doing? He cried.
Was he supposed to run into the wall of water and the cliff face behind it?
Run, John Bandicut, rasped Napoleon behind him.
The water around him exploded with a shotgun blast of rocks. One caught him in the back of the head, and he staggered, half-blinded with pain. The wave was looming almost upon him. A hand grabbed him and yanked him straight into the falls. Water crashed over his head, stunning him senseless. He was aware of shouting and mechanical clanking, and a great crash of rock upon rock. He pitched forward, tumbling into silence. Chapter 4. Ick. Bandicut groaned and sat up painfully, his head spinning. He must have lost consciousness for a few moments. He was chilled to the bone, but he was no longer under the waterfall, or in water of any sort. Where the hell was he? He blinked his eyes back into focus. There was a sun low on the horizon, and a warmish breeze blowing over his skin, and not a snowflake in sight. He was sitting on some sort of grass. What the? He heard a crash and turned to see Napoleon tumbling out of what looked like a shadow in a stone wall. Napoleon toppled over on the soft footing, almost landing on top of Bandicut. A minute later, Copernicus appeared. It rolled a few meters, then shuddered to a halt, tapping like a cooling engine.
"Captain, we appear to have passed through another transition boundary," it announced.
"Yeah," Bandicut sighed, overcome with joy at seeing the two intact. He was still shivering from the frigid drenching, warm breeze or not, but at least he had hope now of recovery. But what had happened to their rescuer?
"Hey!" he yelled. "Hello! Friend!"
Shrugging off his backpack, he clambered to his feet, squishing in soggy shoes. A small meadow lay before him, and there was a low cliff wall to his back.
"Hello!"
he called, cupping his hands. He thought he heard a distant call, but couldn't quite locate its direction.
"Where is the other?"
Copernicus asked haltingly. Its sensor array looked a little bent. "I don't know," Bandicut said. "Scan for him, will you? Nappy, you okay?" The robot stood with a creak.
"I seem unharmed by the immersion, John Bandicut."
Stretching to its full height, it peered one way and then another, and finally sank back to a crouch with a sound remarkably like a sigh. Bandicut echoed the sentiment. "I want to thank that guy for saving our hides, but first I guess we'd better look for some shelter. I don't know about you two, but I need to dry out and warm up." He hoisted his wet bag onto Copernicus's back.
"That okay, Copy?"
"Of course, Captain."
Of course. Loyal servant. Never complained. "How are you two doing, power-wise?" He almost hesitated to ask. "Away from the ship, once their batteries ran down."
"I read my charge at 94%, John Bandicut," said Napoleon.
"Eh?" That was much higher than he would have guessed. They had been running hard for some time now. "Copy?"
Captain, somewhere between 89% and 92%. I must run some diagnostics to interpret the uncertainty."
Bandicut blinked in surprise. "Okay, but first let's find our friend, or at least a place to camp." He started walking, waving them to follow. What could give the robots such endurance, he wondered? Had their hardware, as well as their programming, been altered during the transition into this place? He supposed there was no point in worrying about it right now.
"Anyone know a song?" he asked.
Neither of the robots answered.
The sky was quickly taking on a twilight cast as they crossed the small meadow. Beyond it, a stand of trees half enclosed a rocky knoll. Bandicut moved cautiously and passed under the trees. They looked a bit more earth-like than the ones he had seen in the previous place. A couple of them looked like copper beeches, and several others reminded him of pine or fir. "Take note of the trees, the grass, anything you can put in your databases, guys. You never know what information we might need later." Napoleon, in response, began to zigzag, inspecting the foliage. Bandicut rubbed his arms, thinking that he would be smart to get a fire going. He glanced around for pieces of dead wood and found one half-fallen branch hanging off one of the trees. He tugged on it, and it came loose in his hand. As a sudden thought crossed his mind, he dropped it and stared at his palm to see if the contact was going to make his skin curl up and die. His hand looked okay. Felt okay.
"Your body chemistry has been normalized to meta-ship standard."
"Huh? What's that?" There was no elaboration. But he wondered, did that mean he could eat the local food? That would be a great relief. He heard a snapping sound, and then,
"Gleer!"
Rasp.
"Cow!"
He turned toward the outcropping of rock. Their alien rescuer had emerged from a sheltered alcove in the rock and was beckoning with a wave. Bandicut sighed gratefully. A sudden shiver went through him, and he shook like a wet dog. He needed to get out of his wet clothes. With luck, some clothes in his backpack might still be dry. If he was luckier still, they could build a fire and both warm up. He suddenly realized that the alien was pointing toward a small, flickering pile of wood, a fire already burning. Bandicut waved to the robots to follow, picked up the dry branch, his contribution, and walked to join the alien. He paused at the entrance to the sheltered area, and the alien gestured toward the fire.
"Come."
"Yes, this is right," whispered a small voice in Bandicut's head, a familiar voice.
He started. The alien cocked its head. Bandicut swallowed, thinking, "Dear God, this is no time to start in with the haunting memories. Or, worse yet, silence fugue." The alien stepped aside to let him kneel by the fire. It was small, the flames licking out of what was little more than a pile of twigs. But he sighed over and over in gratitude as he reached out to it, wishing he could drink its warmth through his hands and wrists. Rasp. Cold, said the alien, crouching on the other side of the fire. The stone in the alien's right temple glimmered as it spoke. Bandicut stared at the tingling stone in his own wrist. He sensed that it was working hard to translate the sense of the being's various words. Except for the rasp of uncertainty, the sounds of the translation were indistinguishable from the alien's own voice. He looked up earnestly into the alien's sculpted blue face and felt the sudden full impact of what was happening. An alien. His life had just been saved by a flesh-and-blood being from another world. His mind reeled at the thought. Yes, he whispered, answering the question at last. Very cold. The two robots lumbered alongside and parked themselves. Bandicut got up with a grunt and lifted his sodden backpack off Copernicus. My supplies, he explained. The alien, whose face was shadowed now in the dimming twilight, angled its head for a better look. Bandicut opened the bag and tilted it so that his host could see into it, or at least feel that the gesture had been made. He reached in, groping for dry clothes, and pulled out a jumpsuit and some underwear. They were damp in spots, but a lot drier than what he was wearing now. The air was cooling quickly as the daylight faded, lending urgency to his actions. He shook out the clothes and held them for the alien to see. He tugged at the wet fabric clinging to his body. "Dry clothes," he said as distinctly as he could through the quaver in his voice. "I'm going to change." The alien remained silent, perhaps waiting for him to demonstrate. He hesitated, feeling a sense of absurdity. Here he was, in a historic encounter with an alien species, and the first thing he was going to do was undress. It couldn't be helped, of course, and there was a certain logic to it beyond the necessity. He might as well let the creature see what he looked like, and perhaps reassure it that he wore no weapons. He took a breath and quickly unzipped his soaked jacket and jumpsuit, stripping naked. He grabbed his spare clothes, then hesitated a moment, though he was trembling and covered with goosebumps. The alien studied him with interest and spoke again in that tongue-rolling tone. "Clothes?" "Yes." Bandicut started dressing hurriedly, then hunkered back down by the fire. It was faltering a bit, and he puffed gently on it. He picked up his dry branch, cracked it over his knee, and propped the pieces over the tiny flickering flames. The alien responded by picking up something from the grass on its side, another piece of dead wood. Snapping it in two, the alien placed the pieces of wood carefully beside the fire, not on it, but beside it, saving it for later. Bandicut nodded, rubbing his hands together. The alien, too, crouched close to the small flames, extending its own hands. They were larger than Bandicut's hands, with three long articulated fingers, bony but powerful looking, and two opposing thumbs per hand, giving them the look of strong mechanical grippers.
"Warm."
"Warm," Bandicut repeated. He looked up into the alien's eyes and realized suddenly that he was not the only one who had gotten soaked in the frigid waters. Was the alien suffering from the cold, too? It was wearing a smooth body covering that looked like leather and was probably as wet as Bandicut's clothes. Maybe that was why it had vanished after pulling Bandicut to safety, to hurry and get a fire going. Bandicut tried to read its expression, but couldn't. The being's face was angular and rather high and narrow. It had a horny-looking mouth that protruded slightly and appeared to have a fixed curve to it. There was no visible nose, but its eyes were close enough to being human-like, though smallish and deep-set in bone-ridged sockets. Its gaze was intense. There was a diamond-like sparkle deep in its eyes that seemed to be more than just reflection. Its head was hairless and sculpted with smooth indentations and bulges. "Are you cold, too?" Bandicut asked. The stones pulsed in his wrists as he posed the question. "Cold. Ick-k-k-cold," the alien agreed. After a moment, it cast a sidelong glance at the robots. They won't bother you, Bandicut said hastily. He hesitated. My name is Bandicut. He pointed his hands back in at himself. John Bandicut. The alien sat back a little, eyes flickering. It seemed to consider this for a moment. Ick, it said finally, pointing a finger at its forehead. Your name is Ick?
Ick,
the alien repeated, with a sharp emphasis, as though to clarify the pronunciation. Ick, Bandicut repeated. The alien grunted, perhaps in satisfaction. It, or he, Bandicut decided, based on nothing more than intuition, made a small sweeping gesture toward Bandicut.
John. Band.
Bandicut. John Bandicut. Ick raised his head slightly, then lowered it.
John Bandicut.
John Bandicut, do I know you? There was a whispering movement in his thoughts, like a breeze fluttering around loose papers in an old attic. Bandicut felt a sudden upwelling of sadness, mingled with hope. Charlie? But there was no further sound. He wanted to believe it was Charlie's voice he had just heard, but there had been too many echoes of memory haunting him lately. Charlie had returned to life once before after dying, but much more quickly. Best not to hope or believe. He felt tears welling in his eyes. At that moment, a waft of smoke from the fire caught him in the face, and he coughed violently. Ick sat back in a crouch, hands raised a little, in what looked like a defensive posture. He was undoubtedly uncertain about Bandicut. It would only be natural. What could Bandicut say to explain himself? The alien's eyes flickered with a glint of blue. Ick, Bandicut whispered, thinking. I know I should be excited, but I'm cold, tired, confused. The warmth from the fire was ever so slowly seeping into him. Where are we, Ick? This is all new to me. Do you live here? Do you know this place?
No.
Ick rose suddenly.
Not my place. Cannot.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.